Johnny, get your gun, get your gun, get your gun.
Take it on the run, on the run, on the run. Hear them calling you and me,
every son of liberty. Hurry right away, no delay, go today.
Make your daddy glad to have had such a lad. Tell your sweetheart not to pine,
to be proud of boys in line.
Over there, send the word, send the word over there.
Soldier, keep singing, Nora.
Weather lights.
Oh, suppose the generator's gone again.
Hit your lights and play them on the stage so we can keep going, will you?
All right.
You do that fine, thanks.
Switch.
Hey, boys, hit your lights and keep them on the sing until the others come up, will you?
Certainly.
That's fine. Thanks very much.
Let the Yanks are coming, the Yanks are coming. The drums rum drumming everywhere. So prepare, say a prayer. Send the word to beware.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage Scott Berg.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me back. Nice to see a lot of old friends again. That is either the best introduction or the worst introduction I could ever have, because, I mean, how do you follow Jimmy Cagney? In Yankee Doodle Dandy, 1942, Warner Brothers. Cagney won the Academy Award, by the way, and that was Francis Langford singing over there with him. It's a very significant song. It's not just a wonderful song. It didn't quite get written the way you saw it, you know. There it is, and it is one of those incredible American songs that became a genuine anthem, certainly during the First World War, and it became so powerful a tool, a recruiting tool, that it was used again in World War II as well, to kind of mirror where things went. So anyway, that's that. So now I'm going to try to pick up some of the pieces and bring you down to some reality here, but not without thanking Jamie Kabler for having me back. So for any of you newbies out there, you'll realize what I realized 5 or 6 years ago, that when Jamie calls you and asks you to come to this, you can either surrender early or you can surrender late. But by Godfrey, you will surrender. So just know that. I learned the hard way, but anyway, here I am, and very happy to be here. And I would like to thank all of you also, because, you know, in 5 years, you've turned this into a major cultural event in this country. And celebrate yourselves, you know, because there are very few communities in this country that could pull this off. It does take a madman or a genius to make it happen. Not sure. We'll go with genius tonight, but we'll put it to a vote later. And here you are. It's become an institution already, and it's just fantastic. But it really required this community to get behind it, and it's just an absolutely wonderful thing. So I'm here tonight to talk about two of my favorite topics, actually, which come together in a book that I worked on. The first is perhaps the most important but least understood or least known or least studied, at least in this country, event in modern human history. And it is something that occurred exactly 100 years ago, and as telegraphed, that clip wasn't just to show you Jimmy Cagney, it was World War I. And this has now really been reduced in the history books and American knowledge to something like the Punic Wars or something. It's just something that happened, nobody quite knows when, why, where. And this is a real shame because it's an extremely important event that happened. America entered this war 100 years ago last year in April of 1917, and the war was over 100 years ago this year in November on the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month, 1918. So that, in and of itself, I think, is worth remembering this year and as we carry on through the year. The second, a great passion of mine, as well as my interest in World War I, because I think it is so fascinating, and many of you heard me speak about Woodrow Wilson here, and having spent 13 years studying his life and then writing about it, I know, and I hope many of you start to appreciate the importance of World War I, not just to him, but to the country and indeed to the world. The second great passion of mine is 20th century American literature. And I was given a great opportunity by an institution called the Library of America. And I hope you all know what the Library of America is, but I fear most of you don't. And I will tell you that that has just celebrated an anniversary too, which is its 35th anniversary. And the Library of America is a publishing house in New York, which decided, well, it began to decide almost 50 years ago, but actually went into operation 35 years ago, to publish all of the great American authors in authoritative texts, in uniform bindings that were both beautiful but affordable. And many of you might have seen they're books this size, but they're usually in black tuxedos with a single author's name on it. You'll read, you know, they have 9 volumes of Henry James, a couple of volumes of Scott Fitzgerald, Ring Lardner, whomever it is, and so forth. And every now and then they do a book on a theme. And they came to me about 2 or 3 years ago, they saying, the 100th anniversary of World War I is coming up. Would you be interested in putting together an anthology of the great writing from World War I? And I thought that's very exciting, because for me, some of the greatest writers came out of World War I. Scott Fitzgerald, Ernest Hemingway, William Faulkner, John Dos Passos. So great, I signed up. And then they said, oh, no, we're not doing fiction, actually. So, the old bait and switch. But what they wanted to do was to publish nonfiction of the moment. And they said, what we would like to do is have you gather enough nonfiction pieces that will tell the story of World War I and will also illustrate how magnificent the writing of that period was. And so a team of scholars got together and began to pluck things together, and we had this incredible team of historians, military historians, social historians, people who study race in America, gender in America, and we had about 1,200 pieces to play with. And then they gave them to me, and they said, okay, you can have about 130 of these. Now, which of those 130 will allow you to tell the story and demonstrate the great American writers of the period, which I then began to put together, and it ended up this book, which I can tell you is really great, and I can say this because I get no royalties for this, because basically I didn't write anything in it other than the interstitial material setting it all up and an introduction. But you will come across in this book not just a very portable history of this incredible war and what happened during those 4 years, 1914 to 1918, but you will also come across some of the finest writing you will ever see in your life. There were certainly the great reporters of the period, Richard Harding Davis, Floyd Gibbons, John Reed, Nellie Bly, who's a name many people know, but they don't realize she was one of the great roving reporters during that period. I didn't really know until I began to put this book together that Edith Wharton, the great novelist of New York society, wrote some of the greatest reportage of World War I. She was actually at the front lines in Belgium and France, sending back these very gritty stories of what was happening out there. But beyond that, you see, because we wanted just contemporary writing from that moment, I went to, in the end, many of the politicians, the great voices of the day, William Jennings Bryan, Theodore Roosevelt, Eugene V. Debs. How about Oliver Wendell Holmes on the bench? And we have a couple of excerpts from his writings about some of the alien and sedition cases that were coming before the Supreme Court at that time. But I also wanted songwriters. I wanted you to read some of George M. Cohan's lyrics to see what the war was about. I wanted you to read the first political stand-up comedian in America. He was a cowboy from Oklahoma. He used to come out on a stage, twirl a rope, and Will Rogers would just sit there and spin stories about the politics of the day, and the president of the United States is 5 feet away, and he's just spinning and spinning. But we should know that, because all that, this American stand-up political humor begins with World War I. And I wanted some of the ordinary voices, the unfamous voices. I wanted voices of soldiers, of mechanics who went overseas, of farmers. And I discovered that, you know, not that education in this country has slipped drastically, but when you begin to read the letters of these farm boys back home, you realize they were all steeped in the Bible and they were steeped in Shakespeare. And people who had gone through the sixth grade wrote some of the most beautiful letters you will ever read. I mean, I insisted we include a couple of letters from a captain from Independence, Missouri, who was writing letters back. He wanted to become a haberdasher. That's all he wanted. But he was writing these lovely letters to his fiancée back in Missouri. So things like that. Oh, and the nurses, my gosh, some of the nurses who went over there, these incredibly brave women who went over and wrote some of the most fantastic diaries anybody has ever kept. And of course, the greatest voice of the age, the most significant voice of the age, one of the most educated voices of any age, and that was the President of the United States, Woodrow Wilson. The last of our presidents to write all his own speeches, all his own articles, all his own everything. And you will see what a towering intellect he was and just how magnificently eloquent this man was. So I wanted his speeches throughout to be kind of tent poles for where this country was going during the 4 years of the war. So I wrote an introduction for the book, which is really the only major writing I did here, other than letting the story unspool so you can see what was happening all the time. But I realized as I was pulling these 130 pieces together from the likes of people I just told you about, that there was a theme that kept popping in and out of the book, and it was one of identity. And I realize that's kind of a vague term, but I kept finding throughout diaries, throughout letters, throughout newspaper articles, this feeling of identity kept coming up. I realized that this war began because a teenage terrorist in the Habsburg Empire, assassinated an archduke in one corner of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. And when he was finally captured and put on trial, he said he was fighting for his identity because he was a Bosnian Serb, you see, teenage boy. And he felt absolutely no allegiance to the emperor of Austria, of Austro-Hungary. So I thought that was kind of a telling thing. So much of the reason the war happened, and it happened very quickly, that it all came together. It broke out because of militarism and nationalism that was spreading throughout the world. Well, what is nationalism but an assertion of identity? And here were these vast empires, the Habsburg Empire, the Ottoman Empire, the Romanovs, and the Hohenzollerns in Germany. And in three of the four cases, they were huge empires within Europe and Asia there, which had just begun to collect territories and cobble together these empires. And as our man who assassinated the Archduke found, he didn't feel any affinity toward his leader. So how are nations put together? What is a nation? People began to raise these questions. And so these are the things that were trying to get answered in World War I. And then I thought, what was going on in this country? Now, the war broke out in Europe in 1914. And because of a lot of alliances made among all these empires, all of Europe began to fall into place, and they're all fighting each other. Woodrow Wilson, the president, in 1914, began to insist on strict neutrality during this war. He said, in fact, we even had to be neutral in our thought, that we couldn't even think of one side or another. And this went on for a couple of years as basically German aggression began to move not just Woodrow Wilson, but the entire country bit by bit, such that by 1916, 1917, our going to this war seemed fairly inevitable. And so I think one of the things I really wanted to get into in putting this book together, and what I want to talk to you about in the next few minutes, is how American identity, the United States, who we are today, how so much of that got created 100 years ago, in fact. And I don't think you can really understand who we are as a country today, as a people today, unless you understand who we were exactly 100 years ago. I can give you one quick historical and political example. In January of 1917, the Wilson administration wanted an armed ship bill passed, and Fighting Bob La Follette, the senator from Wisconsin, filibustered it. He fought it, and it was a very effective filibuster. It went on for days, such that, in fact, the first term of President Wilson was over, Congress closed, and the bill didn't get passed. And this so infuriated the President of the United States, he said, listen, I believe in the filibuster, although he didn't really. He really wanted to have a parliament, so he wanted to be prime minister more than president, I think. But that being the case, he said, I respect it, but there should be something called cloture, in which these debates, these filibusters, can be brought to a close. And so it came about that the Senate began to develop rules, or immediately developed rules, for cloture. Now, ultimately, after, you know, the sinking of the Lusitania happened in 1915, various incidents were breaking out on the Atlantic in which Germany kept torpedoing neutral ships, British ships, American lives were being lost. Wilson tried to do everything he could diplomatically, but clearly it just wasn't happening. And it finally reached a crucial point where on April 2nd, 1917, Woodrow Wilson called for a joint session of Congress, and he came in and addressed both houses. And he delivered what I consider the most important foreign policy speech, certainly of the last 100 years, maybe ever in many ways. Because in the middle of this speech, he delivered a handful of words that have really changed everything this country has done in its foreign policy. And the words famously are, "The world must be made safe for democracy." Now, a lot of people in the room didn't quite know what he meant. A lot of people didn't necessarily like it. A lot of people just didn't get it. But within seconds, they were all on their feet cheering. And indeed, as a result of that, there was a declaration of war just a few days later. Now, what those words mean are still up for grabs. They've been used and abused, misused for a century now. Was the United States on this world to be peacemakers, or are we there to be peacekeepers? Was the United States, was what Woodrow Wilson saying, that the United States was now meant to be the policeman of the world? A lot of people think so. A lot of people think it should not be that. In any case, there has really hardly been an incursion in the last century anywhere in the world where the United States went, whether it was Vietnam, whether it was Iraq, whether it was Afghanistan, wherever. Pick your crisis. But in some way or another, and sometimes it has been articulated by the president himself, in one way or another, those words of Woodrow Wilson from World War I have been and they remain the foundation of American foreign policy. As a result of these words also, Wilson was adding a moral component to American foreign policy. I mean, here we were, thousands of miles and an ocean away from a continent that's ablaze. And Wilson now has to convince a country that it is in our best interest to go over and fight in that war. Now, that's a tough sell. That's a really tough sell. We were an isolationist country. We were buffered by an ocean on each side. Why is that suddenly of such importance to a farmer in Missouri to go over and fight in that war? And it was this moral component for Woodrow Wilson that was the most important. Woodrow Wilson, who was the descendant of a dozen Presbyterian ministers. Woodrow Wilson, who was probably the most moral and the most religious president we have ever had. And it was important, he said, not just as Americans, but it was really important for Americans as human beings, and that we had such richness in this country that we had a certain moral obligation that we had to deliver on. And so indeed, that did become the foundation for American policy. And as a result of that, what had been a kind of sleeping giant arose and became the first modern superpower in the world. Now, the foreign policy is certainly plenty important. But there were a lot of changes that were made in this country domestically over the course of the war. Suddenly, you see, the government had to go big. Suddenly, in order to go to war and win the war, to mobilize, there was an alphabet soup of thousands, and I mean thousands, of boards, agencies, committees, and commissions. World War I prompted Woodrow Wilson now to bring the biggest men in American business to Washington, D.C. Now, it wasn't called this just yet, but this really is the beginning of the military-industrial complex, as Woodrow Wilson is starting to wed big business, or business that was getting bigger and bigger, with the military and putting them all together. He's bringing in people like Bernard Baruch, to run the War Trade Board. So now we have this incredible mixture, you see, of business, of financial people working with the military. The economy changed drastically, of course. Woodrow Wilson did not invent the income tax, but he certainly modernized it. What had been 1% on $3,000 went to 2%, and then it went to 2% on $1,000. There were surtaxes that were now being charged, some that went as high as 67%. Again, people had never been paying an income tax. Many people in their lives had never paid an income tax. And now some people were paying two-thirds of their income, you see, to pay for the war. There were war profits taxes. The federal deficit in this country went from, get ready, $1 billion to $9 billion. We had war bonds. And this was a really interesting phenomenon, the selling of war bonds, because it occurred to Wilson he needed really good salesmen out there, sort of the way George M. Cohan could write this song, and everybody got whipped up. Wilson began to think, how can I whip people up into buying bonds so they can pay for a war 3,000 miles away? And he realized there was a brand new phenomenon, not just in the country, but in the world. There was a new business, a place called Hollywood, that was cranking out movies. And not only could you use movies as propaganda, but there were a half dozen people in the world who were like gods. I mean, these movie stars, this new phenomenon, people named Charlie Chaplin, Douglas Fairbanks, Mary Pickford, William S. Hart, the stone-faced cowboy, you know. And Wilson sent them out to sell war bonds, which they did phenomenally well. As a result of these war bonds, we developed something new called a debt ceiling. This began as a tool from the Treasury Department so that it didn't have to go to Congress each time it wanted to float a bond. They went to Congress and said, why don't we set a ceiling here and we don't have to keep coming back to the trough every time we want to raise more bond money. And indeed, the Congress would set a ceiling, which got revisited many times. And I'm told the debt ceiling has been raised several times since in the last century. We had to build an army and a navy. The United States had an army of 130,000 people, mostly men. 130,000. If you listed the armies of all the countries in the world, we were about 17th between Serbia and Portugal, okay? And now over the next year, we are gonna have an army of 4 million men, a navy that went from 60,000 to 500,000 to transport those 4 million across the Atlantic. We developed something called the Selective Service System. And this, in many ways, is one of the most interesting things that ever happened to the United States, this selective service system. Because suddenly, you couldn't pay for somebody to go to the war for you, as could happen in prior wars. Now there were going to be local boards all across the country in which local people would determine who within their district was going to be going to war. And as a result of that, you see, you may find some scion of an old Harvard family in the same trench with a farmer from Iowa. So things began to get mixed up here, you see. This really was a time in which the melting pot actually began to melt a lot of the different elements that were in the country. And race begins to enter the picture here as well. 400,000 African Americans would serve in the First World War. This became an extremely important sociological phenomenon. Make no mistake about it, the armed forces were still segregated. The blacks had the worst jobs they could possibly have. They were in charge of digging trenches, latrines, burials, dragging bodies off of fields. But 400,000 African-American soldiers served because they believed this was their ticket into American society. They believed by earning their red badges of courage, this would be the moment for them really to be treated as full-fledged Americans. So they weren't fighting shoulder to shoulder necessarily, but they were at least on the same side. As a result of their being away and the whole social order changing in the country, there was a great migration of African Americans moving to the North. And indeed, the most important thing that happened, I think, for the African American movement is that in 1919, after the war was over and the soldiers came home, all the 4 million white American soldiers had these incredible parades up Fifth Avenue in New York City. The African American soldiers did not come home to any kind of hoopla, nothing like that. And they found, when they got home, that they were treated just the same as before they left, or worse. And as a result of that, we encountered something in this country in the summer of 1919, which is called the Red Summer. And it's called the Red Summer because for that entire summer, riots broke out across the entire country, not just in the South, not just in the industrial Midwest, but in all corners of this country. And this is the moment where the blacks really rose up for the first time and formed a real unit, and they had a real message, which is, why aren't we being treated the same? Black mothers lost the same sons that white mothers lost. A lot of them saw their sons return without limbs the way white families did. And as a result of World War I, then, you see, and the malignant neglect on the part of the Wilson administration, this was the moment, I think, that the modern civil rights movement, such as we know it, really has its birth. Now, the other great game changer that happened in this country during World War I was the role of women, because now women were leaving the household in big numbers at this time, working outside the home. There are not a lot of very good statistics on what happened in this period, so I can't throw them at you. But for the first time, even black women could work at something other than being domestics. They would become cafeteria waitresses or elevator operators, as long as they wore their white gloves, you see. But suddenly, the whole game board is shifting. We also had Woodrow Wilson going to Congress and getting, or trying to get, the vote for women, trying to get the amendment passed in the Constitution giving them suffrage. Now, Wilson had been resistant to a constitutional amendment for several years, but once we were in the war, he became an adamant proponent, that's what I meant to say. And he all but brought the ball over the line during the war, and shortly after the war is when women were fully enfranchised. But Wilson, the main point he made is, this is a wartime measure. He said, first of all, how can we be fighting for democracy thousands of miles away when half the people in this country are not even enfranchised? And second of all, he argued, women had really earned the vote, which indeed he had to suggest, that you still had to earn the vote. But he did, because while the war was going on and those 4 million men were overseas, it was the women in this country who were really keeping the country going and keeping the home fires burning. Wilson also reactivated a lot of the Alien and Sedition Acts that hadn't come into play for decades, if not centuries. And as a result of this, the ACLU was formed. That had formerly been an anti-war group, the American Union Against Militarism. Fighting all this, Wilson organized the Committee on Public Information, which became a lot, depends how you look at it, it was either a great propaganda agency, or it was something basically just trying to foster great enthusiasm for this war and for the American way. Agriculture went off the charts in the United States during the First World War, because we were able to produce so much food, and the United States became the great breadbasket of the world. We were feeding not just our soldiers, but we were feeding a lot of starving people in Europe, most especially in Belgium. You know, as a result of World War I, we got daylight savings time. And twice a year, you change your clocks. And that's because of World War I, because Wilson realized, boy, if we have an extra hour of daylight, you can be producing more food. You can be out in the fields doing that. And that became the case. The war was won. As said, we declared war in April of 1917. We really didn't enter the war until 1918, until the spring of 1918, until May of 1918. We really didn't get into the fighting. And this country really fought for 6 months. During that time, we lost 100,000 men. I mean, there were just some massacres in some of these battles. The war became so important to Woodrow Wilson because he thought, if we could help win the war, we could write the peace. And Wilson had a great plan for writing the peace. He codified it. He wrote down 14 points, in fact. And he thought this should be the result of this war. And the 14th point was the most important. And it was something that he called the League of Nations. And Wilson had this idealistic notion that if we had this table, almost like King Arthur's round table, where every country could come and sit. In fact, if they joined, they would have to come before they ever attacked another country. And if they did that and sorted everything out on the table before they went to war, we might just have fought the war to end all wars. And this was his vision for the League of Nations, for the 14 points. And indeed, he got it. There was a meeting for 6 months in Paris where the heads of all the participants in the war met. They drew up a peace treaty, and it included all these things. It wasn't a perfect treaty by any means. A lot of good things did happen. Belgium was restored, Alsace was returned to France, Poland was recognized, but there were some compromises that had to be made in the end. Japan versus China, especially, and Japan got some things that China didn't think they deserved. And Wilson couldn't risk a walk out of Japan at this conference table, and so he surrendered, gave it to them. And what may be the greatest legacy of World War I, just in sheer numbers, is that there was an uprising in China when that part of the treaty went through. And there was a young student named Mao Zedong who got so swept up into this movement, what became known as the May 4th incident, and he became a radical newspaper publisher and was one of the 3,000 people who gathered in Tiananmen Square. And this was a man who was completely changed by something that happened in World War I. And back home, post-war disillusionment kicked in. After the war was over, Wilson was replaced by Warren Harding, elected in 1920, inaugurated in 1921. We had a whole new era in this country. But out of it, what happened in the 20s was some of the great fiction I had hoped to include in this book. But if you think about it, Jay Gatsby meets Daisy Buchanan at Camp Taylor during World War I. Jake Barnes in The Sun Also Rises gets his famous wound in World War I. Frederick Henry and Catherine Barclay in A Farewell to Arms. Faulkner's first book was called Soldier's Pay. And so on and on the list goes. And so, in essence, almost every aspect of American life to this day, you see, goes back to World War I. And I was just going to suggest that over the next few days, as you listen to other of the authors, this murderer's row that you have about to appear before you, And sure, listen to them. Listen to them. But every now and then, you might pull yourself out. No, wait till they finish, but then pull yourself out. And just ask yourself, especially the people doing nonfiction, but even the fiction, and ask yourself how much of this actually goes back to the foundations of things that happened 100 years ago. And I think you will find that most of the themes that are with us to this day were forged in the great fires of the First World War. Thank you very much. Thanks.